the end of this topic, you should be able to understand the importance of PERT, locate the critical path, determine the project completion time, and find out the probability of completion of a project before the stipulated time. Now, let us assume that you are a project manager and you are working on certain project. So you have to take certain decisions, and there are a lot of questions that you need to answer, like when should I start this project if I wish to deliver it after 1 month? What are the critical activities in my project? If this activity get delayed, will it hamper the project duration? And what is the chance that project will be completed as per the schedule? To such and many questions, you need certain answers, and these answers can be found out with the help of techniques of project management. The two techniques are critical path method, that is CPM, and other technique is PERT, that is program evaluation and review technique. So let us understand what do you mean by PERT. So PERT stands for program evaluation and review technique. It is a tool which helps the project manager for project planning and control. It enables the manager to continuously monitor the project, and if there are certain lacunas or if there are certain delays, he can take the corrective actions whenever necessary. Now, PERT is little different from the CPM, that is the critical path method. In PERT, we assume that it is not always possible to have the precise time estimation for each activity. Instead, probabilistic estimation of the time is possible. In CPM, we assume that, let us say, we assume certain activity of a construction, constructing the walls. We assume that it will take certain time, but it may not happen every time that you can complete the given activity within the stipulated time. There are a lot of variables due to which the time, activity time, may get varied. For example, if everything goes right, it may take 10 days to construct a wall. So what I mean by everything goes right, that material is being supplied on the time, labors are available, there are no delays in anything, and if everything goes right, it will take, let us say, 10 days. Let us assume that there are certain delays, the material is delayed, labor is delayed, and due to other factors, it may take some 14 days. And in worst case, if everything goes wrong and you have challenges in material, in labor, and in other things, it may take 20 days. Now, this is your probabilistic estimation, right? So we are not saying that the activity will exactly take 10 days or 14 days. We are having some probability of completing the given activity, and this particular estimate is called as a probabilistic estimates. And PERT make use of this kind of an estimate. So there are three time estimations that are used in the PERT. The first one is called as an pessimistic time estimation. If everything goes wrong, what will happen, what time it will take? Optimistic time estimation, if everything is right and goes well, what time it will take? And most likely time estimation, that is the average time estimation, right? So we calculate this expected time with this formula. So your T0 is your optimistic time estimation in plus 4 times most likely time estimation plus pessimistic time estimation divided by 6. So with this formula, we can calculate the expected time for a given activity. And these two are the standard deviation and variance. How to make use of this? Let us see. We will try to understand this PERT with one example. Now, there is a project which consists of these 7 activities, and the time estimation are given in this way. Now, as we know that project activities have certain precedence, meaning that activity B will start when activity A is completed, or this activity E will start only when this activity B is completed. So this is the project or activity precedence. Now there are three time estimations are given. One is optimistic time, most likely time, and pessimistic time for each activity. Next thing is to calculate the expected time, and which is calculated with the help of this formula. So these are the three things that are given in the problem, and we can calculate these values of expected time for each activity with the help of this formula. Now, before we actually begin the PERT, we need to understand how the network diagram is constructed. So network diagram consists of events and activities. So event is represented with some number. Starting event is represented by 1, and we make circle over the number. Activity is represented by an arrow and the name is given, and the activity duration is represented below the activity name. In this way, we will now construct the network diagram for the problem given to us. Now, the first activity is activity A, and this activity will start from the first event. Now, we will mark over here our first event, and we will have activity A. As activity A do not have any precedence, that is the starting activity, it will emerge from the event 1. Now, activity A will complete in event 2. So I will mark event number 2. From this event, now the activity B will emerge, because B is dependent on A, C is also dependent on A, and D is also dependent on A. So there will be 3 activities which are coming out of this event 2, right? Because activity A is ending at this event. Now we have these 3 events, event number 3, event number 4, and event number 5. Now you can see that I have marked this activity E. Now this E activity is dependent on this activity B. So where the activity B is ending, my activity E will start. Next, my activity F. So this activity F will start from the event where activity C is ending. So activity C is ending in this 4 number event, and from which this activity F will start. And now you can notice that this activity G is starting from the event where all these 3 activities are ending. So activity D, E, F. So activity D, E, and F are ending in 1 event, that is event number 5, and from this event this activity G is emerging, and it will go to the event number 6, which is the last event. This is your complete network diagram for the project given over here. If I start from event 1 and if I go to the event number 2, then if I go to the event number 3, 5, and 6, it will give me one way to go from event starting event to ending event, and this can be represented by this way. If I start with again 1, if I go to the 2, then I will go to the 4, then I will go to the 5, and then 6. It gives me some different path. And if I start with 1, 2, then 5, and 6, it will give me a third path. So these are the 3 paths where if I start from starting event and if I go to the ending event, These are the three different ways I can go for. Now let us calculate the duration for each of these path. So for first path, it will take 22 weeks, because if we add all the activity duration, that is 5 weeks plus 3 weeks plus 6 weeks plus 8 weeks, it will give us the 22 weeks value. For second path, it will be 5 plus 8 plus 7 plus 8 will give me 28 week of time. And for third, 5 plus 4 plus 8 will give me 17 weeks of value. Out of these three values, this path takes the longest time, and this becomes our critical path, or it is the time required to complete the project. So this A, C, F and G becomes my critical path. For further computations, we will consider only critical path activities, that is A, C, F and G. This is the optimistic time that given in the problem, this is the most likely time given in the problem, and pessimistic time given in the problem, and the values of expected time that we have calculated with the help of formula. Now for all these activities, we need to compute the standard deviation values, and this standard deviation values is given by this TP, that is the pessimistic time minus optimistic time divided by 6, and these values are given by these figures. Next thing we have to calculate is the variance, which is nothing but the square of this standard deviation. So I get the values like this. Now these values of standard deviation and variance are related to the activities, but we have to calculate the standard deviation and variance for the complete project. So the variance of the project time, or for the complete project length, is given by sum of the variances of a critical activity. So if you add all these four values, you will get value as 2, and from this variance value we have to compute the standard deviation for the complete project. So the standard deviation of a complete project is given by square root of this variance. So I get the value of standard deviation of a project as square root of 2. Now we have been asked to find out the probability that the project will be completed in 30 weeks or less, and that is why we have calculated the standard deviation and variance. To calculate this probability, we have to calculate the value of this Z, and which is given by this formula. Now here the given value of T is nothing but this 30 weeks that we need to compute, and this is the expected value of T in critical path, right? So this is the 28, which is our critical path duration, and standard deviation of a critical path that we have computed, that is nothing but the square root of 2. Once we compute the value of this Z, we will go to the probability distribution table. This probability distribution table is given in exam, and which you can use. Now I will search for this value of Z, that is 1.414, in this table. So I will find out the row with this first decimal point, so 1.4, and I will look for the value of 0.01, so which is given by this particular column. So this is my figure which I need. Now once we add 0.5 to this figure that we have got over here, right, we get the value of 0.9207, and that is nothing but the probability which I required. So 0.92 is the probability that the project will be completed within 30 weeks, or in other words, there is a chance that it will be delayed after this 30 weeks is 8%, which is nothing but the 100 minus 92. In this way, we can compute the probability of completing the project within stipulated time. Thank you.